what we will do is discuss the boundary conditions. We have a second order Orentz differential equation, and then to solve that we require two boundary conditions, and that is what we will discuss now. Second order ODE, two boundary conditions are required. Now, so far we have been telling that whenever we came across this example that the fluid clings to the bottom plate also clings to the top plate, and this fluid does not move, and this fluid moves at the same velocity as the top plate. Okay. So far purposely I have not used a very formal terminology, we used a very little informal terminology saying that it clings. Okay. What is the formal terminology? It is called as no slip condition. Okay. What is the formal way of expressing a no slip condition? Let us read that and then we will discuss. The tangential velocity of a fluid in contact with the solid surface is same as that of the solid surface. Okay. So, that is what we have been telling, that the fluid clings, which means that whenever a fluid is in contact with the solid, the velocity of the tangential velocity, okay, can have normal velocity also. Now, we are discussing about the tangential velocity. The tangential velocity of the fluid is same as that of the solid. If we now apply the velocity of the solid surface here is 0. So, velocity of the fluid, let us say the fluid layer just in contact with the bottom surface is 0. Now, what about the fluid layer which is just in contact with the top plate? It gets the same velocity as that of the solid now, which is moving at the Vp. That is why we said the here also the fluid clings to the solid and gets the same, the velocity of the fluid is same as that of the velocity of the solid. Okay. Now, why do we say it as no slip condition? Slip means there is some difference between the velocity of the fluid and the solid. When there is no difference in velocity, there is no slip or slippage between them. That is why we call them as the no slip condition. Okay. So, to summarize this boundary condition, the no slip condition means that there is no difference or no slip between the velocity of the fluid adjacent to a solid layer. It gets the same velocity, the fluid acquires the same velocity as that of the solid itself. If it is stationary, fluid has no velocity. If it is moving, fluid also moves along with the same velocity. Okay. So, now once this is clear, then we can write down the condition for Vx at the bottom plate which is fixed, Vx is equal to 0. What is the value of y? Y is equal to 0, that is at this point. Okay. Fine. And at the top plate which is moving, what is the velocity? It is moving at Vp, which we have set. So, what is the velocity of the topmost fluid layer? That velocity is Vp. What is the value of y? The y coordinate is h. Okay. So, these two are the boundary conditions written based on no slip condition. What are they? At the bottom plate, the velocity is 0. So, velocity of fluid is also equal to 0. At the top plate, the plate is moving. So, velocity of the fluid is same as velocity of the plate, and at the bottom plate y equal to 0, at the top plate y equal to h. Okay. Now, let us summarize the differential equation along with the boundary conditions. Now, I like to mention that physics stops here, max starts here. So far, we have arrived at this equation based on the Navier-Stokes equation, which represents conservation of linear momentum. And then, based on the no slip condition, we wrote these boundary conditions. Also, like to mention the no slip condition is an experimental observation. We can't prove the derive the no slip condition. Experimentally, it is observed that the velocity of the fluid in contact with the solid is same as the velocity of the solid. So, it is experimentally observed that the velocity of the fluid is same as that of the velocity of solid. So, it is experimental observation. Let us say if you keep measuring velocity closer and closer to the wall, you observe that the velocity of the fluid and that of the wall becomes same. So, this equation has the physics of the linear momentum balance behind it, and based on that, that equation represents, I would say, one simplified form of the linear momentum balance. The boundary conditions are also written based on physics, which is no slip boundary condition. Now, if you recall back, you would have done courses on mathematics, on calculus, differential equations. In those courses, you would have been given a differential equation with the boundary conditions. Now, this is a situation now where you have formulated the differential equation yourself along with the boundary condition. There some equation was given, you would solve as a mathematical problem. But now, all the differential equations represent some form of conservation equations. Now, because you know the conservation equations, you yourself have arrived or derived the differential equation and stated the boundary conditions yourself. So, putting in another way, now you have formulated the question yourself. Okay. So, that is why I said from now onwards what we are going to do, simple max. Okay. Just what you would do in a typical first year engineering calculus course. Given a linear first order differential equation along with boundary conditions, how do you solve? Okay. That is all we are going to do. So, let us do that. This is very much known to you. So, integrate once, we get dvx by dy is equal to constant c1. Let us integrate once again, you get vx is equal to c1 y plus c2. Now, we will have to evaluate the constants c1 and c2, okay, for which we use the boundary conditions. Okay. So, we use the first boundary condition, vx equal to 0 at y equal to 0. So, if you substitute in this equation, you will get c2 equal to 0. This of course, certainly would have done several times in your calculus course. Now, let us use other boundary condition, v x is equal to v p at y equal to h, and so if we substitute in this equation, of course, c 2 is 0, left hand side is v p, right hand side is c 1 into h. So, c 1 becomes v p by h. Okay. The first boundary condition was here, second boundary condition was at this location. Here the velocity is 0, here the velocity is v p. So, now when you substitute in this equation, you get the velocity profile v x is equal to v p by h into y, and that is the velocity profile which we have been seeing so long. Almost from the beginning of the course, we have been looking at this velocity profile. We said that we will derive towards the end of fluid mechanics part, and that is what we have done now. And if you want to represent, this is the pictorial representation, velocity varying from 0 to v p at the other end. And remember, they are all shown as vectors. It is a velocity vector directed along the x direction. Okay. So, in that way, it is a kind of, I would say, milestone. We have been looking at this several several times, and today's class we have derived it. Okay.
Okay, having derived the velocity profile, we can derive the equation for the pressure profile or the pressure distribution. And we have seen there is no pressure gradient along the flow direction, dou p by dou x equal to 0, and then there is no pressure gradient along the z direction also, okay, that is this direction, okay, and there is pressure gradient only in the vertical direction, which is the same as the condition of fluids at rest, just a hydrostatic pressure distribution. So, pressure varies only in the vertical direction. So, let us integrate that. So, if we integrate, we get p equal to minus rho g y plus a constant, and at y equal to 0, we specify a pressure which is shown here, some p naught. And so, if we substitute in this equation, you evaluate C 3 P naught, left hand side is P naught, this is 0. So, C 3 is P naught. So, let us substitute that, and you get this as the equation for pressure distribution, P naught minus rho g y, which just tells you that the pressure varies linearly with y. It increases if you go down or decreases if you go up, and that is what is shown here. This is pressure P naught. At the top plate it is P naught minus rho g y, and y is h. So, it is P is equal to P naught minus rho g h, and of course, the distribution is given by P naught minus rho g y. Okay. So, it varies linearly from P naught to P naught minus rho g h, which is same as that in a static condition. Okay. And the pressure distribution here is hydrostatic. And we can also see that because the flow is incompressible, absolute pressure has no meaning. We always talk in terms of pressure difference. So, we always find pressure to an arbitrary constant. What does it mean? That is why we said at some position y equal to 0, we are given the pressure P naught. So, this you get an expression which tells the difference in pressure P minus P naught is equal to minus rho g y. Always you find in an incompressible flow up to an arbitrary constant, that is a more formal way of saying, and that is what we are seeing here as well. Okay. That is applicable for all the incompressible flows. If it is compressible, the absolute pressure can be determined, and that has a meaning as well.